Firstly, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the chance to speak at this conference. And so I'll be talking about the Rotor-router model, which is, so far you've been hearing about SANDPILES, and it's related to this, to the abelian SANDPILE model. So it's in the same sort of general class of models. So just to remind you, Lionel defined something called stack models, abelian stack models, which I'll just remind you of. So an abelian stack model is specified by specifying two things, rho and m. So m tells you, if I receive n chips, how many chips do I send out? So in the SANDPILE model, you know, if I receive 5 chips, I only send out 4. If I receive whatever, 100 chips, I send out all 100. But if I have 101, then I just send out 100 and keep the 1. So let's try to describe a random walk by this sort of, in this sort of framework. So firstly, for a random walk, if I receive n chips, I will send out all n of them. I keep none. And rho, which is a stack, which is called a stack at each side, is a set of instructions where to send the nth chip that I have received. So for a random walk, my rho n, so rho n will be a sequence. So rho of x, and for a random walk, it'll just be a sequence of random directions, and so on. So basically, every chip I receive, I send to a random neighbor on every side. So this describes random neighbor, right? Now, that describes the random walk in this abelian stacks framework. Now, let's think about how to de-randomize, you know, this random walk model, which means I will keep, you know, I want the walkers to walk, but I want them to walk in a deterministic way. So the simplest thing I can do in this framework is, of course, if I receive n chips, I want to send out all n of them. But this one will now be a periodic sequence of neighbors, which means, practically, which means this. The first chip I send out to the right, and then up, left, down, right, up, left, down, and so on. So this, if I specify my stack as a periodic sequence, this gives me a deterministic model of something walking on a lattice. And at every site, every 4 walkers go in 4 different directions. So that's what is called the random walk model, rotor-router model. So this is a very nice model. It shows self-organized critical behavior, and its relationship to the random walk has been studied by lots of people, including Lionel and James Propp and their collaborators. But the SOC part of it was studied 20 years ago, and since then, not a lot of progress has been made in the SOC part. So I just want to highlight, you know, it's a very nice model, beautiful model, and there should be more progress made on the SOC and FES versions of this. For example, we know if there's just one walker walking on the lattice, it does Eulerian tours on the lattice. But what if 10 walkers are walking? You know, what is the state if I do random sequential update or something? So we don't know. So okay, also it shows very nice properties like the coupling lemma and all the other things that Daniel used in the SANDPILE model to derive various theorems. All those things hold for the rotor-router as well. So it's just that, you know, not a lot of attention has been paid to this one. Okay, so I will be studying the rotor-router on 2D. So on a 2D square lattice. On a 2D square lattice, how do you, there's a nice graphical way of defining the model, which is, every lattice site has an arrow attached to it. And that arrow points to one of the neighbors. Right? That's like the current state of the stack. Now, if I put a walker here, what it'll do is, it'll rotate this arrow by 90 degrees, and then move in the new direction. So if I put a walker at the center, it rotates this arrow and moves in the new direction. Now the worker is here. And then it keeps on moving. So this was introduced by Deepak, Abhishek, and Supriya Krishnamurti in 97 in the context of SOC, and by James Propp in this de-randomized context, or random walk. Sorry. So, okay. A particular arrangement of these arrows I will call as background or as the configuration. So a particular arrangement of arrows, now if I put a walker on it, it'll change the background. Okay. So the walk is abelian. So let's say I have a sink somewhere outside the lattice, and the walker will walk throughout the lattice and reach the sink. Now, if I put another walker and then it walks and reaches the sink, no matter, like maybe I can put both the walkers together and then walk, you know, in any sequence I want, and then they both reach the sink, the final arrow configuration will be the same once they have both reached the sink. So that's the abelian property of this model. So also, if you think about it, if my walker explores some area on the lattice and then goes to the sink, right? There's my big lattice. It might not explore everything, but it reaches the sink. Now, all these arrows point in the direction in which the walker exited them last. The walker exited site at the last time it visited it in this direction, and so on. So you can see that I can't have a loop of arrows like this, because if I do have a loop of arrows within this visited sites, then where did it exit? Right? It has to exit it because all these arrows are the last exit. So I can't have a loop, which means the set of arrows within the visited region has to be loopless. So it's called a spanning arborescence. Okay. Rooted at the sink, so the last arrow has to point to the sink. So the odometer function, which you know people have described for this for SANDPILE models, for the rotor-router, we also call it the visit function, which is it just counts the number of times a site is visited. So it's the visit function up to a specified stopping point, like all the walkers have reached the sink, or I can specify like hitting times of a subset or something, and then that gives me a visit function on all the sites that the walker has visited so far. It's a spanning arborescence on the visited subset. Not on the, I just cut off all the other sites. On an L cross L box, I'll take it on. Okay. So once I know the visit function and I know the initial arrow configuration, so this is A, not sigma. So if I know the initial arrow configuration, I can tell what the final arrow configuration will be, because if I rotate it 5 times, I know that if I started like this, I have to end up like this. Right? Because it's through one rotation and then come. So the visit function specifies everything, basically. And it obeys the equation, the stack Laplacian, which Lionel defined earlier. You can define them for any of these stack models. It's related to the Laplacian. It's just a small change. Is the final arrow, final number of chips on a site minus initial number of chips on a site. So if all the chips have left my lattice, then basically stack Laplacian of V will be 0 everywhere. So the question is, how can we guarantee that a solution that we find for Vij is actually the correct visit function? If it is? So yeah, I'll tell you what you need to specify to get a unique solution. So let's say I have a solution for this equation. How do I know that it is the correct solution? Right? So turns out these conditions guarantee the uniqueness of the solution. So firstly, the final position of the walker, let's say it has reached the sink. Vij at the final position. So if I say how many times the sink has been visited, if it's a normal sink, it's just been visited one time. But so the Vij at the final position is an input I need, is a boundary condition. The support of Vij, and the final error configuration being loopless. As I said, you know, the final error configuration on the support of VIJ is loopless. So if I find a solution for this equation which satisfies these conditions, I know that that solution is unique and that is the correct solution, and I know the correct final error configuration. So it's just an algorithm for starting with, which was devised by Tobias Friedrich and Lionel Levin. So there's an algorithm for starting with an initial guess for V. And because solving the rotor-router on anything just means determining the V, right? So whatever problem I have to consider in the rest of the talk, I'll have to basically find the correct V. That'll be solving my problem. So what you do is you start with an initial guess, find out the stack Laplacian. That stack Laplacian will have, hills and holes. So it'll have pluses, you know. There'll be some sites where the stack Laplacian is plus 1 or plus m. There'll be some sites where it'll be minus m and so on. So what you do is you start new walkers from the hills and let them walk until they reach the holes. That gives you, basically, that reduces this by 1 each time I do this. So, and finally, I'll have a guess for the visit function, which is stack Laplacian equal to 0. And then you have to get rid of the cycles in some way. So if I might have loops, I get rid of the loops in some way. Then once I do that, I satisfy all these four conditions. It's loopless, boundary conditions, support, and stack Laplacian is 0. So then my problem is done, right? OK, so this is what I'll use. OK, so another thing that I'll consider is, let's say I start a walker at some site on a big lattice, right? Does it straight away go to the sink? Or does it keep visiting this initial site again and again? So you know that random walks in d equal to 1 and 2 are recurrent. And in d equal to 3 and higher, they're transient. Similarly, for the rotor-router, d equal to 1, almost all initial backgrounds are recurrent. You keep coming back to the origin. And in d equal to 3, recurrent initial backgrounds are not known. OK, so d equal to 2 is the special, as you know, for the random walk, d equal to 2 is a marginal case between recurrence and transience. Similar to the rotor-router, you can make large classes of backgrounds in d equal to 2 which are transient, and you can also have large classes which are recurrent. So firstly, let me show you an example of a transient background. And there's just one walker. Now I put a second walker, it will do more walks, but basically these walkers will go straight to the sink. Now, a lot of questions. So many times the initial question that people ask in these things is, what happens if I start with a lattice where the arrows are pointing in random directions? Right? So this was studied by Apri and Dar, and this is what you get. So this is after 10 to the 5, and this is after time 10 to the 7. So as you can see, the walker does not go to the sink. It just keeps coming back again and again. These color code is the number of visits to a site. OK, so the number of visits increases as you, because the inner sites are visited again and again. And the radius keeps on growing. So this is what you get on a completely random initial configuration. OK, the arrows are pointing in random directions. So Dhar and Kapri conjectured that the limiting shape for this thing is a circle. So as it goes bigger and bigger, the limiting shape approaches a circle. And they conjectured that the fluctuations of the boundary follow a KPZ scaling law. So to remind you what a KPZ scaling law is, if I have a surface which has a height L, the variance of height of the surface is OK, so that's the KPZ law. So basically, what they said is the fluctuations of the surface are not Gaussian. If it was Gaussian, if there were just random fluctuations, then it would be L. So they are L to the power 2 by 3. OK, that's the conjecture. So the questions I wanted to answer are there 2D recurrent backgrounds like this? So on the recurrent backgrounds, you can see you can make it interesting shapes. On a transient background, there's just a path to infinity. There's no interesting shapes. So are there 2D recurrent backgrounds for which one can determine the exact limit shape? That's the first question. Here, the conjecture was a circle. Are there cases for which I can determine the exact limit shape? The second question is, are there such backgrounds where I can prove that the fluctuations are in the KPZ class? Right? That the fluctuations actually scale as 2 by 3. And then the final question concerns the relation between recurrent and transient backgrounds. So is there some parameter I can vary so that my background gets less and less recurrent, and a path to infinity opens up? And finally, at some value of my tuning parameter, the walker just goes directly to infinity rather than visiting the origin again and again. So those are the three questions I'll try to answer in the talk. OK. And is this a phase transition? And you know, what tools of the machinery of phase transition can I use? OK. So I'll study things on 2D. So I'll study periodic, or rather perturbations of periodic backgrounds. So my notation will be, tell you this should be present with probability P and this with 1 minus P. And then I can fill up my lattice with these sorts of unit cells with probability P and this sort with probability 1 minus P. So that's how I generate all the initial configurations that I study in my talk. Okay, so if P equal to 1, then you see that this is just the perfect tiling with these two cluster units. Okay, so this is the initial background that I want to consider. No, you can have loops in the initial configuration. That cannot be stuck. It cannot be stuck in a certain region, because if it was stuck in a certain region, look at the arrows on the boundary. At some point, this arrow has to get rotated and point out. So it cannot get stuck in a finite region. It has to keep growing. OK. So I'll just show you. So this is the simplest background that I consider. And in numbers, so I'll use numbers to denote, you know. So this is 0, this is 1, this is 2, this is 3. It's useful to have numbers, because if I know a site has been visited 5 times, then I know that my final configuration will be whatever, mod. This will be my final arrow direction. So it's 0. So I know that if this site has been visited 5 times, it's now pointing in this way. OK. So this, I'll specify my lattice unit cells like this. So let's look at what happens if I start with a lattice tiled with this unit cell. And how does the walker walk? OK, so it's started at the origin, and now it's walking. It's exploring some region, keeps coming back to the origin. You can see the walker as the blinking dot. So it keeps coming back to the origin and keeps revisiting all the sites that visited, and then increasing the area that it has visited by 2, the boundary by 2. So this, you can tell, is recurrent. This is a recurrent initial configuration, right? So it just keeps on growing this. So now I'll just show a simulation where, like, I've just taken stills at the point where the walker revisits the origin. So we'll see the growth of the pattern in a faster way. OK, you saw what happened. So it's just, this pattern just keeps on growing. It's a very simple, nice square pattern, right? OK. So the visit function for this pattern is also easy. So this is what the pattern is, right? The visit function is just, it's like a pyramid. It's a tent pyramid. So the visit function is, it decreases linearly with slope 2 in this region along the y-axis, x-axis, y-axis, x-axis. Right? That's the visit function. Okay. So if I've stopped it after the origin has been visited m times, so at the origin, the visit function is m, and everywhere else, it falls down linearly. Okay, so this is the simplest background. Now, let's add noise to this background. As in, started with everything 0313. Now, I'll change p percentage of them to, sorry, this is, sorry, yeah, 0312, and I'll change a fraction p of them to 0313, just changing the background randomly. So I'll now get a slightly random, I'll get these sorts of unit cells at random positions in my, on my lattice. So what happens then? This is what you get. So you can see that these are the positions of the random cells. In these patches, they didn't make much of a difference. It's just, you know, the boundary is just the way it was perfectly square, slightly rounded at the edges. And in this region, it has created some interesting structures, right? And those structures have also changed the boundary. You see? So what is happening here? That's the question I want to ask. So why are these structures being created? How are the noise, you know, my perturbed cells creating these structures? Can I, you know, describe the new visit function in some way? Okay, so yeah, the resulting pattern shows a number of curious features. First is in three of the patterns, in three of the patches. So I call these four things patches. So in three of the patches, it's not changed. The visit function is not really changed in a very non-local sense. In one, it is. So I call these things terraces. So these are outward facing terraces. So, you know. So these are terraces, and okay, whatever. Now the question is, can we predict where the terraces will arise and explain the new shape of the boundary? So this is what I did in this paper. Okay, so an exactly solvable case. So let's say, consider, so basically it's this only. This is the exactly solvable case. Now I want to study it systematically. So let's say I just take my initial background, but just one cell in each patch has been changed. So it's like this. This is just, you know, one cell in each patch. This is slightly a wrong picture, but whatever. One cell in along each axis has been changed. Okay. So now, what happens? So what happens is, I just have to do my algorithm for start with an initial guess for V0 and then finding the correct V0, right? So my initial guess for V, visit function, will be the unperturbed V0, which is just the pyramid, right? That's my initial guess. Now let's see, let's calculate the stack Laplacian for my initial guess. What happens? This is what happens. Everywhere it's 0, so it's the correct visit function in these regions, it seems. But here, I get a hill and a hole. So a hill is red. And here also, I get a hill and a hole. OK. So now what I have to do in the algorithm to find the correct V is start new walkers at the hills and let them walk until they reach the holes. So once I do that, and also I get rid of all the loops and so on, I get this. So what did the new walker do? Right? It created a terrace in my configuration, final configuration, and all these sites it visited 4 times before reaching the hole. Started from a hill, visited all these sites 4 times, and then it reached the hole. Which means the new visit function, my improved guess for the visit function in this region, is my old guess plus 4. Okay. So basically, whenever you cross a terrace boundary, the visit function increases by 4. That's the rule. Similarly, if I start with 2, now I want to look at interactions. Like, okay, I know what each unit cell does, each perturbed cell does. What happens if I put 2? What happens is, let's say, I put them such that the Vs that they would generate intersect each other. What happens? What happens is, they just create a W. Okay, so just a single terrace, and all of these sites have been visited just 4 more times. If my initial guess was correct, if I didn't consider interactions, I would think these sites would be visited 8 times. No, that's not correct. What happens is the first guy does this, and the second guy just visits these sites, didn't visit these sites at all. So it just erases this boundary. Okay. So that's what happens when I have 2. If I have 2 where the V's are inside each other, then they sort of stack up. So these sites are visited 8 times more, these sites are visited 4 times, and these sites 0 times more than my initial guess is correct here, but I have to add corrections to it in these terraces. Okay. So also the final one is, let's say I have a site which would create a V, but I have another site here. Then what would happen? Would it create a new terrace, or what, you know? So it turns out it doesn't create a new terrace, nothing happens. It just nicely sits there. Okay. So I have defined my interaction rules between my perturbations. So these are the rules. These denote the noise, you know, the perturbed cells. And this is my patch, which is growing. This is where my initial guess is correct. Now I draw terraces, and every time I cross a terrace, I increase my, so my initial guess has been to be corrected by adding a 4. So here I have to add an 8. So this is just a graphical representation of the rules of how to draw my terraces given where my perturbed cells are. Okay, is everybody following? Okay, so this is, you define, so to keep track of these guesses, these corrections, you define a height function as a difference between the final V and the initial guess, which was just the tent. Hij increases by 4 every time you cross into a terrace. All right. So these rules remind you of something. So at least they reminded me of something. And to many people in the audience, they'll remind them of something, which is the anisotropic directed percolation model, which was introduced by Rajesh Indar and also studied by Johansson. So I'm not going into details of the model, but basically what you see here is terraces which look like this. In the model, you get regions which have been percolated, and they look like this. Okay, so you get terraces. Every time you cross into a terrace, you increase the height by 1. And you can shift these things slightly to get things which look much more like the terraces we see in our picture. So this is very much like, and all these edges are present with probability p, which is exactly our model, right? Basically, in the ADP model, whenever I have, with probability p, I generate these things, then I join them up, and every time I cross, the height increases by 1. Okay. If my height increases by 4, it's just a multiplier. So, okay. This model, and turns out, I mean, this model can be solved, right? So this is how you project it onto a 2D lattice. And this can be mapped to what is called the 5-vertex model. And you can solve it exactly. Okay, so you can determine the average height exactly. You can determine the fluctuations using Bethe-Ansatz, and everything follows. This has been studied by a lot of people, including Kiron here. And the solution, so this is what Rajesh Indar determined. They determined the average height. Okay, so translating their results into our model, so divide by 4 is, so multiply by 4, basically, everything. So this is my guess for the average terrace height. So my average correction to the visit function. So my new visit function was V0 plus H. So my average correction here gives me the average new visit function, right, in my patch. So I know what the average visit is. If I know what the average visit function is, then basically, given I know my V, I can tell where my V goes to zero, which means I know the shape. So, which means this is basically solving the shape of my recurrent pattern, right? What about the fluctuation? So, if you recall, one of the questions I asked initially was, is there a non-trivial recurrent background for which I can solve the shape exactly? And this is, you can do it for this case. So this gives me the shape. And also, I want to point out another nice mapping. So I showed you the ADP mapping, right? So another nice mapping is if you look at the contours of the if you draw contours of constant visit function, then if I have two perturbed cells here, does this remind statistical physicists in the audience of something? This is the polynuclear growth model. The polynuclear growth model is, I start with a flat surface, then I deposit things on it, and they keep growing. So I can deposit something here. And finally, they merge at some point to form a bigger. That's the polynuclear growth model. So it's just, these edges grow like this. This grows like this. And all right. So this is exactly what is called a discrete polynuclear model, which also has been exactly solved, because all these models are very related to each other, and they can all be solved by using the Bethe-Ansatz. So, but an advantage of looking at it this way is it's very obvious that the fluctuations are KPZ. So the polynuclear growth model has KPZ fluctuations. And so it's very obvious that my fluctuations in my height function will belong to the KPZ universality class. And for this model, you can solve them exactly. So this is the solution by Priyadzev using the Bethe-Ansatz. There's other solutions in the literature, but this is for exactly the shifted height model, so I like it. So this gives you what my difference between, so my, what my probability distribution of this is. Okay, so this is, it says it's some constant function which depends on P, is my fraction of perturbed cells, the site, and a Tracy-Widom GUE random variable. Okay, so this is for the statistical mechanists in the audience. This is growth from a wedge, so GUE. Okay, so all right, so how do these predictions compare with simulations? So basically, I know the exact functional form of P, the fluctuations in the height. So not only do I know the exact shape, but I also know the functional form of the fluctuations. So okay, so how do these predictions compare with simulations? So I can measure the histogram of fluctuation. So this is what it is. So this is the histogram of fluctuations of the height. I haven't scaled it or anything. I have fit a shifted Tracy-Widom to this. But you can see the fitted values for the mean and variance are very close to theoretical predictions from this and this. So just the secular shift of 2, prediction is 170 for the mean, and the actual fit is 172. It's just, you need to get the shift correct, so that's why I use the fitted thing rather than, otherwise it would be correct distribution, but it would be slightly shifted, the whole of it. 10,000 patterns, average. So I don't get the tails, but in the center, I can get the correct values without the fit, right? So variance is 13.53 is the, and 13.57, it's within the error bar. Okay, so basically what I'm showing is the fluctuations do follow Tracy-Widom, and I can determine the exact shape. So that's the exactly solvable case. And what happens as I change P, right? So now, I'll slightly shift to studying the transition between transience and recurrence. Okay, so I just have an L cross L lattice, right? And I have a pattern which looks like this. Okay, these are the patches. So let's say I stop the walker once it reaches the edge of the lattice, right? Then what will happen is I can measure how many times it has reached, it has visited the origin before it reaches the edge of the lattice. And for so I can determine V of 0, 0, right? If my pattern is recurrent, then if I start with it on a larger lattice, right? I don't know if this is larger, whatever. Imagine it is larger, 2L cross 2L. Then I'll get the same pattern, because the shape is asymptotic, like the scaling shape I know. So I'll get the same pattern, but V0 will just, so V00L, so V002L will be approximately 2 times V00L with order 1 corrections. Right? So basically my V00 scales with L, so it's proportional to L for a recurrent background. If I had a transient background, then what would happen is if I increase my lattice large enough, then my walker might visit the origin sometime, and then it will find a path to the to infinity and it will go off. So even if I do this on a larger lattice, it will still go off. So my V00 will not increase with L after a while. So my test for transience and recurrence will be what is this quantity? Is it zero or is it non-zero? So my prediction for this pattern is, as I vary p from 0 to 1, the prediction is that it's always non-zero. It becomes very small when p becomes 1. And at p exactly equal to 1, it is transient. But for everything below p equal to 1, my pattern is recurrent, because this limit is non-zero. OK, this just the green line is predictions, and you can see it is non-zero all up to 1. The red line is just some measurements. OK, so that's what. For this pattern, I don't get like a non-trivial transition. If a transition happens at p equal to 1, there's only one configuration which is transient, and all the others are recurrent. It's not a non-trivial transition. So, OK, but you see that it's recurrent everywhere. So now I want to study a pattern for which I see a transition from transience to recurrence. OK, so this, again, in my complicated notation, this is the background. OK, so it's this is the original periodic one, the all the circles. And this is, I've changed it in two different ways. OK, so as p goes to 1, my original goes to 0. OK, so OK, whatever, there's some perturbed cells. And it creates these terraces in 3 regions. OK. So OK, it creates, can I still study it using the same methods I used in the previous case? And can I still know what the asymptotic shape is and so on? That's the question. So turns out not, because there's a slight complication now. You remember that we had rules saying that W's form, and you can have terraces inside each other. And if I have a perturbed cell on the edge of a terrace which forms, then it does nothing. In this case, it does not do nothing. But what happens is it creates a terrace of its own. If it created a terrace of its own with like a former boundary, that would still be fine. You could still solve it. Is the ADP model without the shifted, without the shift. But turns out that's not all it does. What it does is it shifts the original terrace boundary by 1. OK. So now I have not only do I have an extra terrace, but I have a backward shift of the boundary. And with this backward shift of the boundary, it's not exactly solvable anymore. I'll tell you why. So it's easier to see why in, okay, this is all I've said. This is a slightly different pattern, but you see still the same shifting of the boundaries. You can see that now I have my lines of constant visit function have overhangs. Basically, I have a discrete PNG model, but with overhangs. So once you have overhangs, I have been informed that you can't solve it. So once you have overhangs, you cannot determine, you know, it's not mappable to any exactly solvable model. So, you know, I don't know the exact fluctuations or even the exact height shape. But I do know that all these PNG models of growing surfaces, even with overhangs, belong in the KPZ class. So I still expect the fluctuations in the height, whatever it is, to scale like L to the power 2 by 3, or 1 by 3 if you're looking at the mean squared fluctuation. So the fluctuations are still KPZ. So who knows what the distribution of the heights is, right? But if you measure it, all the three Tracy-Widoms look similar in the center. So I don't know which one it is, but it's presumably it's still GUE because you know that's what you get when you have growth from a wedge. But who knows? Oh, this one. It's just I haven't taken enough measurements. So this is an asymmetric distribution you can see, and all three Tracy-Widoms look the same in the center, so I can't distinguish whether it's GUE, GOE, GSE, but it's something. It's an asymmetrical distribution. It's not a Gaussian, right? So who knows what it is? But so it's a, because I don't know the average height either in this case, so the mean is also a fitting parameter. So if you fit with three different things. No, so this is, so basically, yeah. I see what you're saying, yes, I see what you're saying. That is, yes, I could try to do that. Determine the average height first, and then I can see which one it is. Yes, that is true. Okay, so, presumably, it is one of the three KPZs, three Tracy-Widoms. Okay. And the interesting thing which happens here, so okay, I can't solve this thing, so what interest of this? So the interesting that happens here is this thing, which is a signal of my recurrent or transient behavior. For my original case, you saw that as p goes to 1, this goes to 0. But in this case, there is a certain PC, a critical value, for which the number of visits to the origin goes to 0. So there's a non-trivial transition from recurrence to transience. So if you look at, these are two different values. These are the path patterns created at two different values of P. So this is at P equal to 0.05, and this is P equal to 0.45. So you can see that it doesn't reach the origin again, it just goes to infinity. Okay. So I've subtracted the initial background from here, so you don't see the weird structure, because I wanted to make the path clearer. Okay, so this is, yeah, it's transient at this value, but recurrent at this value. So there's something going on between 0.05 and 0.45. So if you plot the number of visits to the origin at different lattice sizes, you can see that for p below 0.40, this keeps on increasing as you increase the lattice size, the number of visits to the origin. But at p above 0.4, even if I increase the size of the lattice, my number of visits to the origin remain constant, and like very small, around 4 or less. So it just visits for the origin 4 times. No matter how big I make the lattice, it doesn't come back. Yes, I guess so. It's an abelian model, so I think it should be You could make an argument. I'm not sure, but yeah. Okay, so this is a transition. Now, given that there's a transition from recurrence to transience, so something happens to these patterns. Presumably, what happens is, you see, there's the most number of terraces are in this region. So presumably, what happens is, this pattern gets longer and longer like this until eventually it reaches infinity, at which point it becomes transient. So it becomes infinitely long in this direction. In the height picture, what is happening? Right? So in the height picture, I have my, you know, eight picture terraces, different heights. So these had a slope. My height function, hij, had a certain slope. Right? So my height function along some direction looks like this. My original visit function, v0, has a given slope that I know, which is 2. Right? So I know that this is my slope 2. My height function has a slope, which let's say m of p. And this m of p increases with p. So at some point, this m of p will become 2. So at the point where m of p becomes 2, I call that pc. Because what happens to my pattern then, right? So if I add these two to get my v will look like this, and so on. Finally, it will look flat. What does flat mean? It's unphysical. It means I have an infinite pattern where everything is visited infinitely many times in a certain region. That's not physical. If something has been visited infinitely many times in a certain region of the square lattice, everything has to be visited infinitely many times. Because my walker can't stay infinitely many for infinite time in a certain region. Which means what happens is, even if v is, let's say, 4 at the center, my walker shoots off to infinity. It never comes back. That's what it means. It's just this sort of picture where it becomes longer and longer in mathematical form. So this transition is known for these terraces in ADP. It's called the wetting transition. So what it means is, let's call all these sites which are below the terrace, this is the XYZ plane, as wetted. These are wetted. These are unwetted. So as I keep increasing p, my wetted plane sort of looks like this. It's the region which is wetted keeps on increasing. And my transition basically happens when the slope of my wetted plane reaches 2. So basically, it's the transition of given a point xy, where does it get wetted for sure? This is the wetting transition in anisotropic directed percolation. It's just like a wetting transition in directed percolation, right? In directed percolation, you can say, does my set of wetted sites go to zero? Like, does it decrease and die out? Or does it keep on going forever? So in this region, in the wetted region, my cluster of wetted sites is going on forever. In this region, there might be some wetted sites initially, but then die out if I look at this at different slopes. So this is the wetting transition. And so, you know, the exponents for the wetting transition are the same here. They just follow from KPZ scaling. You don't need the exact solvability of the ADP for knowing the exponents of the wetting transition in ADP. You just need that the scaling is KPZ. So that we know here. So I don't know if, yeah. So this is the fluctuations of the height. And this is the one-third law. So it's pretty good. Scaling is KPZ. So OK. So that's what, basically, the wetting transition in ADP and the universality class of the recurrence-transience transition in this model, in this case that I considered, fall in the universality class. So future prospects are, can you determine anything analytically about the second kind of pattern or any other kind of, you know, recurrent pattern in the rotor router? And so this is just the conclusions, whatever I've studied. So type one patterns, you can determine the law of the growing pattern, the shape, the fluctuations exactly. Type two, I did numerical studies and showed that there is a recurrence to transience transition. The universality class of this transition is same as the wetting in ADP. Okay, so I've just come to future prospects. I'll finish in 2 minutes. So, yeah, so can I have basically more of these protocols which can be rigorously understood? Maybe, you know, basically it depends on how the contours of the growing visit function behave. So if they have overhangs, can they still be solved? Can they not be solved? What's the... And is it that KPZ and ADP universality? So basically, is the scaling of recurrent patterns on random backgrounds or slightly random backgrounds in the rotor, is it always KPZ? It's still an open question, but at least for these patterns, it seems it is. So, and for the original case which I showed on the totally random background, the measurements show that this fluctuations KPZ. So okay. And also, what happens in the... In 2D, there's lots of ways you can generate a transition between recurrence and transience. So are all those transitions in the ADP universality class? My guess is, the conjecture is, if they happen along a preferred direction, they should be. Is it possible to characterize the transient path of the walker, which I did not do? I just characterized the recurrent growth patterns. What about the path of the walker when it is transient? Who knows? And on the transient side, we obtained proportionate growth. So this I did not show. See, these are the sorts of patterns you get on transient backgrounds if you keep on dropping walkers at the origin. So in the initial background where everything was pointing right, the first walker just went straight off. But I can keep on dropping walkers. And it turns out you get these very nice patterns, which Deepak and I characterized exactly. Not solved, characterized. And let's turn some of the arrows on the initial background randomly to point up rather than right. This is what you get. So in each of the patches that you saw here, you see there's this stereosis. So this stereosis seem to be a generic feature of patterns of the rotor router in 2D. But of course, now there are infinitely many patches. So you know, who knows what the asymptotic shape is, but it's pretty clear that this is still, in some cases, you should be able to determine it exactly for small values of the noise. And as you keep on increasing the noise, the pattern still stays, but some of these patches merge into each other. So then I don't think you can solve it exactly. OK, so any questions?
Any more questions? If not, let's thank Rahul again.